to with your parents.
The Scottish Parliament adjourned on the 25th day of March in the year 1707 is hereby reconvened.
Good morning from the historic heart of Edinburgh on this beautiful summer's day. This morning we're going to witness the symbolic start to a new chapter in Scotland's history, and indeed the history of the United Kingdom. Although the members of Scotland's Parliament have been gathered now for more than 2 months in their temporary home, the Queen is here today to open formally the new Scottish Parliament, 300 years since the last Parliament sat in Scotland's capital. Today, the Scottish Parliament takes over its full range of powers, and the United Kingdom Constitution is irreversibly altered. The First Minister of Scotland, Donald Dewar, wanted this to be a day which reflected Scotland's modernity as well as its love of history. And it will be a mixture of informality and pageantry with the emphasis on youth. 1,600 children are here from every constituency, from towns as far apart as Orkney to Annan. At the moment, the Queen is at the Palace of Holyrood House, which is soon to play a bigger part in the monarch's relationship with Scotland as part of the monarchy's response to devolution. Her Majesty will leave Holyrood in about 3/4 of an hour's time, accompanied by the Duke of Edinburgh and Prince Charles, the Duke of Rothesay, as he's known by his Scottish title. They'll travel up the Royal Mile, through the heart of the old town of Edinburgh, through the Canongate and into the Netherbow, which once marked the beginning of the old city of Edinburgh. Already we can see there the crowds gathering, waiting to see the royal procession. The Highnesses will be travelling up in an open-top carriage, and they'll be led by the household cavalry as they head for the mound. And we can see there this rather forbidding building, which is normally the setting for the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland. But for the next 2 years, it's the temporary home for the 129 MSPs who were elected to Scotland's Parliament more than 2 months ago. And it's this refurbished chamber which is the centre for today's ceremonies. And now we can see from pictures taken just about 40 minutes ago, Sean Connery and his wife Micheline greeting the crowds as they would make their way into the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland. Waiting to be met there by Alex Salmond's wife, Moira Salmond. And the crowds eagerly awaiting, thousands gathering on the route of today's procession to be part of this famous day for Scotland. Now let's join some of our reporters across the city centre to savour the atmosphere and find out a little more about what's actually going to take place this morning. Sally Magnuson's at Holyrood House.
Kirsty, as you were saying earlier, this is where the Queen will be setting off on her procession up the Royal Mile towards the Mound, escorted by the Household Cavalry. The Royal Company of Archers will form a guard of honour behind me in the forecourt here, and the Royal Marines Band will be playing the National Anthem as the Queen leaves. There'll also be, as you can see gathering behind me here, about 650 school children who've been invited specially to observe the event. I suspect though what every eye will be straining to see here is what the Queen will be wearing. Now, this has been a rather tricky one for Her Majesty to get right. Ceremonial robes were considered rather too formal, but an everyday summer frock from the royal wardrobe perhaps not special enough. So we're told that the Queen will be wearing a specially designed dress, decorated with what's been described as a reinterpretation of the thistle theme, and that's got everybody speculating as to what the Queen will look like dressed as a thistle. Holyrood, of course, is bursting with history and always has been ever since the moment when King David I apparently was urged in a dream in 1128 to found an abbey here devoted to the Holy Cross or Holyrood. For centuries after that, the abbey and later the palace of Holyrood House were used as royal residences and an occasional venue for the Scottish Parliament. That historical resonance is one of the main reasons the government wanted the new Parliament to be sited here. Enrique Morales' new building will take shape on a site right next to the palace. It's not a lot of shape to it yet, mind you, but it's true that the new Parliament, to be opened in about 2 years' time, will rise from the debris, bringing once again Holyrood into the centre and the mainstream of Scottish governance. So it's here from Holyrood, Kirsty, where things are really begin to happen. Children all over the place, the Royal Marines Band about to march in here. Back to the studio.
Well, observing the various processions heading for the Scottish Parliament this morning is Alan Little.
Kirsty, the Queen will come out through these gates, the gates of Holyrood House, with the Duke of Edinburgh and Prince Charles, who, as you say, is known as the Duke of Rothesay here. And if this beautiful weather holds, it should be in an open-topped coach drawn by white horses from the Royal Mews. The Queen will sweep past the site of the new Parliament, still very much a construction site, as we saw a minute ago, still very much a building site for now, and then up along Edinburgh's historic Royal Mile. Now, she'll be travelling at quite a pace because the Royal Mile gradient is so steep that the horses will have to keep up a brisk trot to maintain sufficient momentum. The Queen will follow the same route that the last set of parliamentarians took on the 6th of May 1703. That's the last time Parliament was opened, in a ceremony that was then known as the Riding of Parliament. The Queen will pass the High Kirk of St. Giles on her left, where she attended last night a service of dedication known as the Kirking of Parliament. St. Giles sits in Old Parliament Square, where the last Parliament met to, in effect, abolish itself in 1707. And that's where the new MSPs are gathering now to begin their own civic procession in about 10 minutes from now. When the Queen arrives at the General Assembly building, she'll be greeted by Donald Dewar, the First Minister, and Sir David Steele, the Parliament's presiding officer. And those two will accompany her through that imposing archway and into the building where Parliament will sit for the first 2 years of its new life.
The formal ceremony is going to take place is John Milne.
Formal part of the day, probably the most formal part of the day, gets underway. Just over half an hour's time, we'll have the speeches, the gathering of dignitaries. There are some of them already on the way here. As much pomp and circumstance, in fact, as those who planned this modern occasion deemed appropriate. And of course, as Alan indicated, these old stones have witnessed more than most. The Kirk's General Assembly was as much of a parliament as Scotland's had for the last 300 years, and this is its home. Although it's now increasingly familiar, just like that man, Mr. Connery, to television audiences in its modified form as the temporary chamber of today's parliament. He's in the gallery, in the well of this horseshoe chamber this morning, the crown of Scotland, will sit before the Queen. Now, the last time the crown was used ceremonially was in 1953, when the Queen visited Scotland after her coronation, and that occasion is captured here in this watercolour of the young Queen with the Duke and Duchess of Hamilton. It's in a painting by Sir Stanley Cursiter. There was a row at that time, indeed, about how the Queen was dressed as well. It also includes, you don't actually see it in that shot, but a little boy standing on a stool facing Her Majesty. He has since become Scotland's premier peer. The present Duke of Hamilton earlier signed the crown out from Edinburgh Castle and vouched to keep it safe. The crown was then put into a glass-topped Rolls-Royce specially prepared for the occasion and borne in procession from the castle, just uphill from this chamber, for today's occasion. The Argyll and Southern Highlanders escorted the crown, which along with the sword and sceptre make up the honours of Scotland, the Scottish crown jewels. They were first used together for the coronation of a nine-month-old Mary Queen of Scots in 1543. The same regalia were present in the old Scottish Parliament before the Union in 1707, and as each law was passed at that time, the sceptre was touched to the parchment to signify the sovereign's consent. After the Act of Union, the honours were locked away in Edinburgh Castle. Indeed, the crown room was bricked up, and they only re-emerged more than 100 years later, at that time under the watchful eye of Sir Walter Scott, and that sort of romantic theme is reflected in many of his novels. Thank you. The Rolls-Royce now enters the portico of what is actually New College, the Church of Scotland's Department of Theology, on its way to the temporary home of the Scottish Parliament, now being removed from the car to allow the Duke of Hamilton in Highland dress to bear it again. He will be preceded by two heralds. The one who's just handled the crown is Sir Crispin Agnew of Lochnaw, baronet, and during his army career, a famous explorer and leader of army mountaineering expeditions, notably to Everest. And he is preceded by Carrick Persuivant, the title under which Mrs. Elizabeth Rhodes rejoices. That is the office, the oldest of the offices in Scotland's ancient Lord Lyon, King of Arms Court. Now the crown is safe behind the scenes, and there is one other piece of pageantry to come. Under this cloth lies Her Majesty's presentation to Scotland's new Parliament, the mace, continuation of a parliamentary tradition common to the political process of many countries, and this symbol of authority is designed for a new millennium and a new politics by the silversmith Michael Lloyd. It will be formally uncovered by one of the heralds as the Queen ends her address. So, spit and polish time over, all ready to go, Kirsty.
The members of the Scottish Parliament will take part in a civic procession to the chamber in a few moments' time. They've been gathering behind St Giles and Parliament Hall. John Pienaar's there. John.
Well, Kirsty, this was where the MSPs were gathering just a short while ago to hear those speeches. Of course, this was the original home of the Scottish Parliament until it was dissolved in 1707, and it was here that they voted to sign the Treaty of Union, often in exchange for quite large backhanders by way of land and titles and so on. And Robert Burns, a poet, he called them a parcel of rogues. Hopefully he'll think more highly of the current crop of MSPs. Let's look at the scene a little earlier on when the MSPs were gathering here. They've left now this place for the later procession in just a short while, on up to the new Parliament chamber. And for the time being then, Kirsty, back to you.
There we are now, and we'll be back with John Pienaar later. Well, throughout the morning, as we watch these scenes in Edinburgh, some here who hold a mixture of opinions about today's events. Andrew Neil, the editor-in-chief of The Scotsman, he's for a long time been sceptical about devolution. We'll be joined soon by Brian Souter, but Liz Lockhead is a Scottish writer and poet, and Ian Hamilton, a staunch nationalist who sprung to fame in the 50s when he daringly snatched back the Stone of Destiny from Westminster Abbey today. We'll be hearing from them in due course. But first, let's go and look round the streets now, and the civic procession is just about to start coming out there from St Giles, and now we can hear straight from Alan Little.
Well, the civic procession, Kirsty, as you can see, already underway. Gordon Brown there, George Robertson, the Defence Secretary, Helen Little, once until very recently a Scottish Office Minister, and John Reid, the Secretary of State for Scotland. The crowd's building up very well indeed. The MPs at Westminster are processing ahead of the MSPs, whom we can see. Now, these are these are civic dignitaries drawn from the local authorities of Scotland, and they're flanked on each side by representatives of Scottish youth. There's Alex Salmond on the left of the screen now. And as you said earlier, Kirsty, the children of Scotland are playing a very pivotal role in today's ceremonies. There'll be a huge procession of school children later in the day to symbolise that this is really about the future of Scotland. Donald Dewar and Sir David Steele there, respectively First Minister and presiding officer of the new Parliament, they're bringing up the rear of the procession and will escort the Queen through the archway and into Parliament House. This is the old Parliament Square, the High Kirk of St Giles there, filling the screen. This is where the last Parliament sat in 1707, in effect to abolish itself. It was thought then forever, of course, and no one foresaw at that time that 300 years later it would reconvene in this way. There you see the school children drawn from all over Scotland flanking the procession, and this is the pipes and drums of the Black Watch leading the procession. Again, George Reid of the SNP there, who's one of the deputy presiding officers, accompanying Donald Dewar and Sir David Steele. And they're swinging towards the right now, down towards Prince's Street. But before they get to Prince's Street, obviously they'll cut off left. It's not a very long procession that leads them just a few dozen yards or so towards the General Assembly building of the Church of Scotland. Lord MacDonald, Gus MacDonald there, a Labour peer who until yesterday was a Scottish office minister, but of course today sees the handing over of what were his powers to this new legislature. These are Westminster MPs and also the MEPs, and the local people as well as tourists and crowds gathering. During the last riding of Parliament in 1703, the local authority, the City Council, put out an instruction that the streets were to be cleared of all rubbish and that the crowds gathering were to throw no squibs. This doesn't look like a crowd likely to throw squibs. These now the MSPs of the new Parliament, Alex Salmond in centre screen, the leader of the Scottish National Party, John Swinney, his deputy in the foreground. These civic dignitaries, provosts from around Scotland, in the foreground, the provosts of the four main cities, Glasgow, Edinburgh, Dundee and Aberdeen. And these banners you see are being carried by 18-year-old school children from around Scotland, and they represent the eight regions of Scotland. There'll be many more on display later, but they're fashioned not on trade union banners or political flags, but on Himalayan prayer flags. And there's a Buddhist monastery in Dumfriesshire which gave the organisers of today's ceremony advice on their construction. This now the place where the Parliament will sit for its first 2 years. This is indeed where the Queen will arrive in a few minutes' time. Later in the morning, she'll stand on that dais, we can see, while the children are processing at the end of today's ceremony. And that, on the right of screen, the home, temporarily, of Scotland's new Parliament.
Just while we're watching these pictures, a tremendous air of informality, definitely a party atmosphere in Edinburgh. Ian Hamilton, does this have a special significance for you as the man who was one of the people responsible for the heist on the Stone of Destiny? Do you think this is a particularly important day?
Yes, of course it is.
I mean, symbolically important because the Parliament has been working.
Yes, but symbols count. I've waited all my life to see this day. As you well know, it's a rehearsal, as far as I'm concerned, for Independence Day, but it's still an absolutely wonderful, wonderful day. There are so many symbols there. For example, there's the empty crown of Scotland, which shows what the claim of right says, that sovereignty doesn't reside in royalty at all. It resides with the people. Really, the informality, which you mentioned, is one of the great things about it. I've waited all my life, I repeat myself.
And Liz Lockhead, as a writer and someone who comments on the cultural affairs of Scotland, I mean, we're not great ones for pomp and ceremony, and there seems to be quite an interesting mixture here today. I mean, lots of children in Parliament Hall and wandering about, you know, no behind barriers.
Well, I think that's very important, that so many children seem to be very, very excited about today. Now, it's not a national holiday, but it's the first day of the school holidays.
And not for some Edinburgh children,
well,
unfortunately.
Well, that's a shame, but certainly in Glasgow, and the big excitement is, you know, to be here in Edinburgh on a day like today. It ought to be a national holiday, though.
Well, here we see them coming up the stairs. They've come past the statue of John Knox, Andrew Neil.
There's an association between me and John Knox.
I think there's absolutely no association between you and John Knox. But I mean, for all the kind of the carping that's, you know, associated with the first 7 weeks about MPs' salaries and everything else, I mean, in the end, this is when they take the full powers. We must remember that. It's not that the Parliament did not have its full powers until this day and won't actually have them until the Queen meets with the MSPs of Scotland. In that sense, is this really the start of the Scottish Parliament?
I think it is. I mean, the run-up period hasn't been a great success, but this is a symbol of a new age for Scotland, and I think symbols are important, and I think it dawns on the Scottish people too that they have their own Parliament now. And that it begins in earnest. I mean, they're going on holiday now, but when they come back in September,
Here we can hear a little of the Inverness Gaelic Choir. I mean, one of the interesting things about today is the tremendous amount of music that's associated with it, of every kind, you know, youth bands, pipe bands, mass bands. And now, of course, because in medieval Edinburgh, people used to rent out their windows so they could see what was going on in the street below when there was a market or there was a great pageant.
Greyfriars
Bowl. Resurrected him for the day.
You've just come back from there, that shows how important. Even Disney couldn't do that.
That may be one of the enduring images of the day. But then we see it's quite peaceful and calm outside the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland there as we wait for the Royal Party to make its way up from Holyrood House. And again, this idea that Holyrood House is going to be more of a working parliament, palace than it has been. Of course, when the Queen is there, she is working there, but it's going to be more associated, especially because of the proximity to the new parliament.
Well, it might become part of Scotland again. I mean, I've never really felt that Holyrood Palace was part of Scotland. The Queen used it for a couple of weeks in the year, and that was it. Now it will become part of our governance, and it's such a beautiful old building, that's a good thing.
We see Alex Salmond there waiting pensively. And although he, like you, Ian Hamilton, was talking about the ultimate desire for independence of you and people like you, he was talking about the fact that the Parliament today was the beginning, and the people of Scotland have charged the parliamentarians with making this Parliament work for Scotland, in a sense, doing the bidding of the people. But interestingly, Andrew Neil, I mean, all around the time of the referendum, people were very peaceful and quiet and didn't really come out in the droves, but then voted so heavily for the referendum on both questions. And today it's as if people are now calmly waiting to say, well, this is ours, this is our right. You know, we will wait here and then business starts.
Well, the Scots are an understated people, except when it comes to football. and I think that's healthy. It's a mature democracy. We've been around for a long time. And I think now people are waiting to see what the Parliament does. Will it improve our schools? Will it make for better hospitals? And so on. That's the nitty-gritty of politics. And if it doesn't do that, it's not worth having.
Well, you talk about schools and education, of course, is one of the great priorities. And for schools and children today, certainly the First Minister, Donald Dewar, was so sure that he wanted so many children involved that 1,600 are involved from every area of Scotland. And De Beer Parks has caught up with many of them as they wait excitedly to take their part in the procession.
Good morning, Kirsty. Children arriving by the coachload here, 1,600 of them representing all 73 Scottish constituencies. And as we've been seeing this morning, the emphasis very much on the young today, how the Scottish Parliament will shape their future and indeed how they will shape it. Now, they've all been given special sweatshirts to wear. As you can see here, it's a one with a saltire in it. That represents the 1st of July, the first day of the Scottish Parliament, and indeed the first day of a new era for Scotland. Now, Ben, what does being part of today mean for you?
Well, I think it's important because it's a historic day for Scotland, and it's a chance for Scotland to make its own decisions on what it wants to do and how it wants its money spent.
Something for you to tell your grandchildren?
Yeah, it's good to be here.
What bit of today are you looking forward to most?
I think probably the parade, just to be a part of everything that's going on.
Tremendously exciting for you. Now, as you can see, the children have all got banners representing their constituencies. Tell us what your one shows.
This banner represents all the historic events that have taken place in Scotland in the past and all the historic monuments that have been a focus of attention.
Where are you from?
Kilmarnock and Loudoun.
And what do you hope the Scottish Parliament will achieve for you?
Not for me personally, but more for Scotland, to raise the standards of living in Scotland, education, health service and that.
Can you see yourself taking any active role in the Parliament in the future?
Possibly.
Elaborate on that. What would you like to do?
More possibly in the education side of things, definitely, yeah.
Very interested in that. Okay, let's move on here. What will you be thinking today as you march past the Queen?
I'll just be very honoured to actually see her. I've never saw her on TV before.
Uh-huh. What are you looking forward to most today? There's a picnic for you in the park later and bands.
Yeah, I think it's just fun being here because you'll never be able to do it again, I mean, and you're very honoured to be part of it.
Are you very honoured to have been chosen? Only 1,600 out of the whole of Scotland, and you're it?
Yeah, definitely.
What will you be thinking today as you take part in the parade?
I'll just be really happy to be here, and I can't believe that I've got the chance to come.
It's something you'll remember forever and ever, you think? Okay, well, good luck to you all, and enjoy playing your part in history in the making.
Thank you, Abir. And we can look in more detail at those banners and the colours of yellow, red and purple all over the city of Edinburgh, flying in Prince's Street. They will be carried along the procession. There is the historic symbol. There are eight symbols in all. The historic symbol, the symbol of the city, traditional industry, town and village, nature hills, mountain farming, technology and modern industry, river, sea and estuary. And the children could choose which marks they wanted to have on their banners to represent best their cities. Liz Lockhead, this just emphasises the whole modernity of it. In a sense, in contrast to all the kilts and everything else.
Yes, they're a wee bit like kind of corporate logos. I think they're a tiny wee bit disappointing. I've got nothing against the old trade union banners. I thought they were rather splendid, but maybe call me old-fashioned. But no, it's lovely that they've been based on this prayer banner idea, this idea of something non-confrontational. I think that's a...
And what's really going to set them off as well is that when the procession starts, I mean, they are going to be accompanied by the red arrows and Concord flying over the city of Edinburgh. But Liz, just sticking with you, because you wrote Mary, Queen of Scots, got her head chopped off, and so Holyrood Palace is another significance for you. After all, that's where Mary, Queen of Scots spent a lot of her life.
Yes, that's where she witnessed the famous murder.
The murder of Rizzio.
And another one, perhaps. Yes, I mean, it's interesting being in Edinburgh to see how unchanged the middle of Edinburgh is.
Mary of Scots came up the Netherbow.
Absolutely, and Knox talked about the people being seduced by, he didn't use the word seduced, but the glistering coins that whore cast from her purse. So, you know, Knox very, very much against, I don't think against royalty as such, but very much against Mary Queen of Scots, perhaps, you know, because of the religious confrontation, but the sort of seeds of democracy, I think, were happening then.
Now we can go straight over to Ken MacDonald, who is at Edinburgh Castle.
Yes, we're atop the Argyll Tower, which is atop the Castle Rock, and as we talk about history today, it's worth bearing in mind that the Castle Rock is 340 million years old, and indeed the first time this was mentioned as a military strong point was in a great Welsh epic called the Gododdin, which was written 1400 years ago. And behind me on the Mills Mount Battery, they excavated that fairly recently and discovered that prehistoric man had been here about 3000 years ago. So that's a wee bit of perspective for you. Today the main action though on the Mills Mount Battery is the fact that the Royal Regiment of Artillery will be firing the 21-gun salute, and one of the officers involved is Captain Ed Insull. Ed, it's a unique occasion, this, for one particular reason, and that is it is a joint operation. Explain that for me.
Well, yes, Ken, it's quite an exciting day for the Scottish gunners here. You can see down behind us, especially because for the first time since the three regiments have been formed, we're firing together as 105 Regiment, which is the Scottish TA Regiment, 40 Regiment, who are the Lowland Gunners, and my Regiment, 19 Regiment, who are the Highland Gunners. And so for the last time this millennium, it's providing us a chance to not only to get reacquainted, but to fire the guns for the last time to mark the opening of the Scottish Parliament.
Now, these events are always a very intricate piece of military choreography, but today you're having to time your last shot to the moment that the Sovereign's foot touches the ground. How is that going to work?
Well, yes, we're playing a little bit differently today because it's not just the gun salute, there's other things going on, and so we've been slotted into our slot, and that means that as the Queen's foot steps out of the carriage, we have to let our last round go. So we've just done a few rehearsals, a bit of backtracking, some calculations on scraps of paper, and we've worked out that the right time to let the first one go, and all things going to plan, as Her Majesty steps out of the carriage, she'll hear the Royal Regiment fire the last round of the 21-gun salute.
Now, let me know a few trade secrets. Is there actually somebody standing down there who is counting so you don't fire, say, 19 or 20 by mistake?
Well, the first safeguard is we make sure there's only 21 rounds out in the first place, so if we get 22 away, it'll be an act of God, if nothing else. But apart from the officer who you can see with the sword behind us, who actually orders the rounds to fire, the sergeant majors also, who keep the time, count the rounds, and make sure that everything goes according to plan, and keep an overall eye on things.
I noticed that one or two of the gunners down there are women. Is this, should we be surprised by this, or is this just today's modern army?
It's certainly a sign of the times, yes, and whereas women used to be put in certain roles, more and more now the army's opening up to more and more opportunities, and now we have women gunners, and in fact my regiment, which is 19 Regiment, the Highland Gunners, we've taken on women now for the first time, and so they're coming into the regiment, and so far things are going very well.
Ed, thank you, and it's worth bearing in mind that they don't normally fire these 25-pounders, that the women gunners would normally be firing anti-aircraft laser-guided missiles, but it was reckoned that today perhaps a 21-missile salute would be a bit inappropriate.
Kemi Don, thank you very much. Now, earlier this morning, the Scottish Division display team, that's representatives of the six infantry regiments, took part in the wonderful parachute drop over Carlton Hill. Saltires tied to their ankles, the Golden Lions, as they're called, made perfect landings this morning in the early morning sunshine in Carlton Hill. We can see them there floating through the sky. And now we can go straight back to, rather than the quiet skies, to the very busy High Street, where Isabel Fraser has been talking to people from all over Scotland.
Indeed, Kirsty, this point in the High Street, pole position really, if we're seeing a good cross-section of what's going on, and behind me we're about six deep, so let's find out what some of the spectators think of it so far.
Lovely, grand.
Why did you want to come along today?
Well, it's a historic occasion, isn't it?
And you're
going to see the like of this again.
And you're getting a really good view of it from here.
Yeah, fairly good, yeah.
Why did you want to come along today?
Well, I think it's just a historic day to be here and how important it is to the Scottish people and to see it.
Now, let me guess, you're American?
Yes, and I feel very lucky to be here today.
Did you plan to come here, or was it just a bit of a
coincidence? It was just lucky. It was luck. So I feel very blessed to be here.
Have you seen anything like this before?
No.
Now, you've brought along James, who's three, and we've seen him earlier on in the programme. Was it quite important for you that he was able to come along and take part?
Yes, I thought it would be nice for him to remember when he's maybe perhaps 18, 19 years old.
Do you think there's a good mix, actually, because the organisers wanted to get quite a good mix of the modern and the traditional. Do you think they're managing to do that from what you've seen so far?
Well, from here, yes, I think there's a good mixture of things, but I don't know in great detail.
Now, you've come in from Stirling today, I understand.
That's right, yes.
Why did you want to be here and to see it firsthand?
Well, 2 years ago to the day, we were in Hong Kong to witness the handover to China, and this is Scotland's handover. And I see it as a transfer of sovereignty, not to the Parliament, but to the people of Scotland, and I never expected to see that in my lifetime. So I think it's a great day for Scotland.
Do you think they're getting the mix right?
I think so. It's nice to see the young people, and obviously from the programme that has been arranged for later, there's a good mix
indeed.
Of things.
Thanks very much indeed. And back to Kirsty.
Thank you very much. And now our political editor, Brian Taylor, is with the First Minister, Donald Dewar.
Kirsty, thanks very much indeed. Yes, we're here outside the Assembly Hall, where, of course, we're expecting the Queen in a few minutes. Mr. Dewar, you'll be greeting Her Majesty this morning.
I will indeed, and it's great that she's here. She's taken a very full part in proceedings. She's going not only to the opening ceremony, but some of the surrounding events. And it's tremendous. I mean, what is, I think, above all the characteristic is the crowds that have turned out, the goodwill, the friendship. And you know, there's been a lot of talk in newspapers about backbiting, I think much of it with little substance. But I've always said it's this feeling of warmth, this feeling of excitement that is in Edinburgh today, and I think through Scotland, that matters, and which is going to encourage me enormously in all the work that lies ahead.
Tony Blair detained in Northern Ireland by efforts to bring a settlement there.
Yes, obviously we'll miss Tony. He's been a great support to me and all the legislative progress of the bill. But I think his duty is clearly in Northern Ireland. I mean, he cancelled at 4 a.m. this morning, knowing that the talks were starting again in a few hours. And the best possible launch present for our Parliament would be good news from Belfast in the next day or two, and I very much hope that comes.
Do you think you've got the right balance between pageantry and populism here?
Yes, I do, actually. But it's always a matter of opinion. But I think the warmth of the crowd, the way we can interrelate with them, the informality of the walking up the Royal Mile, which was the traditional way they did it in the early 18th century, I think all that has worked remarkably well. But we've also linked back to our ancient traditions in other ways, the crown, the Queen's presence herself. It's a very nice, I think, a very nice example of a modern ceremony, but with its roots properly in our great traditions.
Now, before I let you go, I know you hate giving a personal verdict, but how do you feel yourself on this day of the transfer of power from Westminster?
I just feel excited. It's a very unusual state of play for me, but it's been a long road. An awful lot of people have worked very hard. I think it's going to be a great addition to the range of democratic institutions in the United Kingdom. I think it reflects credit in Westminster that they've trusted us with this legislative power. We're going to use it well.
Thank you very much for joining us. Kirsty, back to you.
And Donald, you're admitting to being excited, and we now see the scene outside Holyrood Palace as we wait for the royal party to appear. And at Holyrood Palace, of course, a beautiful palace inside, and also the classical front there. It was actually the extensions to Holyrood and the transformation of Holyrood was commissioned by Charles II, though we never actually saw what Sir William Bruce the architect did to Holyrood Palace. But Holyrood Palace will actually open out onto the Parliament site in front of Enrique Morales' Parliament building, which will actually spill out onto the Royal Park of Holyrood. You can see there the scene now as we up to the empty site where the brewery once stood. No breweries there for the MSPs, far too busy working. And then up into the Royal Mile. Andrew Neil, I mean, Donald Drew was talking there about the carpeting, but let's talk a bit about Donald Drew himself for a moment, because if you think, you know, Tom Johnson, Willie Ross, the famous Secretary of State for Scotland, Donald Drew has achieved a lot.
Since May 1997, and if Donald's excited, then we know something important must be happening in Scotland, because this is a once-in-a-generation experience for us. And I think he's worked behind the scenes, slowly but surely, during the 18 years of Conservative government when it wasn't going to happen. He still built the case for it, and this is a huge achievement for him. And in many ways, we call him Father of the Nation. That's a kind of Mandela-like status, which I don't think Donald himself
would be the last person to want that.
Exactly. But in a way, he kind of represents what's happening today. He's intelligent, he's low-key, he's a man of the people, and in a way, that's what we want the Parliament to be as well.
Yeah. Ian Hamilton, if you're looking to the Parliament, and I know there has been, we were just talking earlier about the carpeting, what it's actually going to do, and it will be judged on what it delivers on so many different issues. But what do you want the Parliament to be? Do you want the Parliament to be informal, the Parliament to be a different kind of Parliament? It clearly is going to be a different kind of Parliament from Westminster.
Yes, indeed. I think Westminster is an extremely bad parallel to draw with any parliament, let alone the Scottish one, because all they do at Westminster is to elect a dictator and a number of acolytes who shout yaboo at one another across a room. The intention of the founding fathers of the Scottish Parliament was to see that all the business, or a great deal of the business of government, was conducted on the floor of the chamber itself. Unfortunate that we've had a coalition between Labour and Lib, so that they are taking the
but you don't believe for a minute that there's not going to be some yaboo politics here.
No,
surely that is the very stuff of politics, that there should be strong debate. I mean, the worst thing in a sense perhaps for Scotland would be a complete consensus.
Let me make myself clear, Kirsty. The trouble with yaboo politics as we see it in Westminster is that it is utterly meaningless, because all the decisions have already been taken and they're presented to the Parliament for discussion, but we know at the end of the day the majority is going to be whipped into the lobbies. I hope we do not see that in the Scottish Parliament. Debate should mean something. I'm an advocate. The job of an advocate is to persuade. The job of an MSP is to put forward his point of view and persuade the other side to come along.
And you're looking rather sceptical.
Well, I think the Scots should be a bit careful about running down Westminster in that smear way until we show that we can do it ourselves. And the first 7 weeks have not been that encouraging. There's been plenty of yaboo politics in the first 7 weeks. Now, the intention is to be different. The intention is to be more consensus. The intention is for more power to be in committees. Fine, these are good intentions. But a lot of good happens at Westminster. Let's see if we can replicate some of that in a different way.
But you talk about 7 weeks, and isn't it incredibly parochial to say, oh, it's not working in the first 7 weeks?
I didn't say it, but yeah, it would be, but I didn't say that.
But the point is, a lot of these people are incredibly new to politics and are finding their feet. And
some
I think
of them seem new to joined-up writing.
we can see there now, it's called the semi-state Scottish landau, as it's called just now, not the state Scottish landau.
As opposed to the council estate one.
Drawn by the horses, waiting for Her Majesty, the Duke of Edinburgh, and the Duke of Rothesay to come out and make their procession up the Royal Mile. Alan Little is watching that.
Well, this now the signal that Her Majesty the Queen will appear very soon, and we'll catch the first glimpse of that much-anticipated dress, which is designed according to a thistle theme. We'll hear the national anthem played by the band of the Royal Marines. The semi-state landau, the semi-state coach you can see there, drawn by four horses from the Royal Mews. And on the side of the coach, Scotland's coat of arms painted, and a thistle emblem on the quarter panels. We'll get a closer look at that in a few minutes' time.
Well, as we're watching these pictures now at Holyrood House, what kind of day will this be, do you think, for Her Majesty? I mean, she's very much playing a part, not leading this day. Liz Lochin.
Well, it's strange that there has to be a queen doing all this and this towards the end of this century.
Here she comes now. Her Majesty the Queen is coming out. And now we can go straight back over to Alan Little, who's watching the scenes at Holyrood.
Well, the weather has held, a beautiful day, so the Queen can ride in her open carriage and be seen by the people lining the ancient Royal Mile, accompanied there by the Duke of Rothesay, as he's known in Scotland, the Prince of Wales, Prince Charles, and by the Duke of Edinburgh. We haven't yet seen very much of the Queen's dress. We'll get a closer look when she gets out of the coach at the General Assembly building in just a few minutes, because that coach will take off at quite a pace to make sure that the horses keep up the momentum to get up that steep gradient of the Royal Mile. We will hear the national anthem played by the band of the Royal Marines. Gates of Holyrood House, the home of the Queen's illustrious predecessors, who occupied the throne of Scotland before the Union of Crowns in 1603, and the distinctive plumed helmets and breastplates of the Household Cavalry, the lifeguard squadron of the Household Cavalry, normally seen at Horse Guards Parade in Whitehall in London. These horses have been involved in Trooping the Colour, Royal Ascot, the Royal Wedding of Prince Edward, and the Hungarian state visit, all in the last 2 weeks, and have made the journey north for this historic day. Site of the future Scottish Parliament to be ready, scheduled to be ready in 2 years' time. Still very much a construction site, building scarcely begun. It was the site of a brewery, as Kirsty said. And it's to be the home of Scotland's new democracy. Thank you. now into the Cannon Gate. This was, until relatively recently, a borough of itself, independent of Edinburgh, outside Edinburgh city walls. An ancient and famous street up which Mary Queen of Scots would have been driven to open Parliament in the 16th century. Mary Queen of Scots, of course, a direct ancestor of Queen Elizabeth. Now, this is the steep gradient you can see where the Queen's postillion will have to pick up the pace a bit to make it all the way up. The route has been lined with earth and sand to avoid slipping on these old and very distinctive cobblestones that you can normally see on this route. There's protesters there, that wasn't supposed to happen. They broke through the crash barriers there, the police moving in now to stop it. Further up the route is lined by officers of the British Armed Forces. You can see the horses picking up the pace. Now, that's nothing to do with the protest, of course. That's because of this quite steep gradient that the horses have to climb to make sure they get sufficient momentum. Difficult to know what that protest was about, but it seems to have disappeared now. The Queen coming up now towards the part of the route that's lined by officers and men of HMS Sutherland of the Royal Navy. There, one of the protesters with a yellow placard being led off by the police, protesting on the issue of student tuition fees, we're told. We saw a moment ago in the distance the High Kirk of St. Giles, the only surviving medieval parish church in Edinburgh, and a centrepiece of the 16th century Scottish Reformation. The Queen attended a service of dedication there last night. And we heard earlier the national anthem being played. That will be the only time today we will hear the national anthem being played. It will not be played at the opening of the Parliament itself. And that was the first of the 21 gun salute from Mills Mount Battery at Edinburgh Castle. That 21 gun salute, time to end as the Queen arrives at the General Assembly building. A right turn now, making a steep descent towards the temporary home of the Scottish Parliament. And the royal procession approaches now. That rather imposing building, the General Assembly building of the Church of Scotland, the Theology Faculty of the University of Edinburgh, where the Queen will leave the semi-state Scottish coach, as it's called, with the coat of arms painted on the side there. See at last this much anticipated dress. Donald Dewar, the First Minister, Sir David Steele, the Parliament's presiding officer. These the two deputy presiding officers, Patricia Ferguson, MSP, and George Reid, MSP. Scotland's youth again playing a central role, very prominent role here, lining the route as the Queen makes her way towards the Parliament's temporary home.
Statue now, and she's approaching the steps. The Inverness Gaelic Choir continues to sing in the courtyard as the procession approaches. This is a very tight schedule, the ceremony in which the Queen is about to take part. Just in case I don't manage to intervene between the items, let me give you a general feel for it. The programme in the chamber, and for you at home, includes an address by Her Majesty to the Parliament and the formal presentation of the mace. There'll be speeches by Sir David Steele, the presiding officer, and Donald Dewar, the First Minister, both of whom you've seen already. There they are, escorting Her Majesty. And there'll be the reading of two poems. Tom Fleming, rather than being in the commentary booth for this occasion, is part of the event with a rendering of Ian Crichton Smith's The Beginning of a New Song. And 11-year-old Amy Lineker from Thurso has her vision of a future Scotland read by 17-year-old Victoria Joffe. And what you're seeing now is James McMillan, composer of the special fanfare for this occasion. Thank you. Applause for James McMillan's fanfare. Applause isn't common in parliamentary settings, but this parliament has decided that it will be appropriate to debates. And Mr. Connery there in the gallery watching the 129 MSPs, at least at the moment, minus the First Minister Donald Dewar, who will make a special entrance embodying the new parliament of this country. Those elected to this chamber on May the 6th, 1999. The beginning of a new song, it said. Here is the First Minister, Donald Dewar, now coming to take his accustomed place. You'll see a double microphone in front of him. Applause for Donald Dewar. Mr. Dewar will be welcoming. Now, fanfare part two for the royal party. Assume that we are not yet quite ready to welcome Her Majesty and her supporters and the Crown of Scotland, but a little taste there of James McMillan's composition. He wrote it specifically in two parts, he said, with a sort of secular feel to the MPs and a special royal atmosphere for this one. And modern, the Crown of Scotland, the Parliament of Scotland, in conjunction. Sir David Steele, the presiding officer, welcomes Her Majesty.
Majesty, Royal Highnesses, Your Excellencies, my Lords, Ladies and Gentlemen, I have great pleasure in welcoming you today to the official opening of the Scottish Parliament. I'm sure you've seen, Your Majesty, in the reaction of the people outside, that this is the most historic event in Scotland for nearly 300 years. We are particularly honoured that you have agreed to share this occasion with us here in Parliament on the day that legislative and executive authority over our domestic affairs transfers back from Westminster. I trust that the Duke of Edinburgh will not disagree that this ancient capital whose name he bears, with its legal and ecclesiastic headquarters, its worldwide reputation for quality education and financial management, has nonetheless until now seemed like a body with its heart missing. You meet us here in our temporary premises, well known to you as the home of the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland, to whom we are duly grateful. We hope to welcome you to our new permanent abode in 2 years' time at Holyrood. That is not without problems for both you and us, problems which should attract some public sympathy because of their familiarity. For us, there is the usual problem of keeping building costs within the estimates. We are 129 members in this chamber, and we already have the same number of views on the detailed architecture. I suppose now that your eldest son is among us, that may go up to 130. But I have no doubt that we shall in due course see a building of national and international eminence. For you, Your Majesty, there is the normal anxiety about having to tolerate new neighbours moving in. Will they be noisy or keep unsociable hours? I hope that on that latter point, I can at least give you the assurance that we hope to be rather more acceptable on these scores than the current tenants of your Royal Palace of Westminster. Your Majesty, we are aware that you are keeping in touch with the views of people throughout the kingdom, and we are putting in place means of informing you on a regular weekly basis what is happening here of our debates and decisions in the Parliament. And I believe that this will give you a clearer indication than you've had in the past of the temper and opinions of the people of Scotland. The ambition of this Parliament is to bring decision-making and accountability closer to the people and make a real difference in their daily lives. This has been a long and at times difficult journey, but I can assure you that we as members of all parties in the new Parliament are committed to achieving those aims. In looking towards the future, we should not be ashamed to build on the heritage and history that has led Scotland to her present moment of destiny. We will be, and already are, creating new traditions, but they cannot be in a vacuum and cannot be conjured up from ephemera. Like every family, every society, we need our rites of passage clearly marked. Tradition, it has been rightly said, is an heirloom of the intellectual and historical world. Today, I echo the words of Sir David Lindsay, writing in the 16th century in the Three Estates. Now have you heard the acts honourable devised in this present Parliament. To commonweal, we think it agreeable, all faithful folk should hereof be content. This is a happy and glorious day for the people of Scotland, and your presence makes it even more special. It is good that today, once again, we, the elected representatives of the people, are able to welcome Your Majesty, not only as Queen of the United Kingdom, but seated as you are among us, to greet you in the historic and constitutionally correct manner, with warmth and affection, as Queen of Scots.
The Queen rises to reply to the presiding officer. Behind her, the mace, as yet uncovered.
Presiding officer, First Minister, members of the Scottish Parliament. Today is a historic day for Scotland. It is our solemn duty in this chamber, with the eyes of the country upon us, to mark the point when this new Parliament assumes its full powers in the service of the Scottish people. It is a moment rare in the life of any nation when we step across the threshold of a new constitutional age. Over the centuries, the British have sought to acknowledge and promote that pragmatic balance between continuity and change, as we have forged new political structures to respond more effectively to democratic aspirations. This new Parliament and the symbolism of this opening ceremony are rightly anchored in the history of Scotland. The crown placed before us today has been passed from sovereign to sovereign, at least since the coronation of Alexander III in 1294. Your procession this morning from Parliament House recall the link with that earlier assembly which last sat in 1706. And it was in this very building, now your temporary home, that my father, 70 years ago, became the first member of the royal family since the 17th century to take on the duties of Lord High Commissioner. As we move into a new era of government in Scotland, we can draw strength and direction from such landmarks of our tradition and history. We can also draw confidence from the respect and admiration which exists for Scotland, not only in the rest of the United Kingdom, but also across the Commonwealth and throughout the world. This is a society in which the qualities of cooperation, learning, entrepreneurial flair, and national pride run deep. The Scottish education system has proved its quality and value through the positions occupied by Scots worldwide. The Scottish financial sector is recognised as being amongst the largest in Europe. The Edinburgh International Festival is one of the world's leading cultural events. And Scottish sportsmen and women are regularly seen as some of the country's best ambassadors. Scotland is all this and so much more. The grit, determination, and humour, the forthrightness, and above all, the strong sense of identity of the Scottish people, qualities which contribute so much to the life of the United Kingdom. And these qualities reflect a Scotland which, if I may make a personal point, occupies such a special place in my own and my family's affections. As we step forward into this new constitutional age, the test for Scotland and for this new Parliament will be to harness these great strengths, to channel them through the energy of the young and the experience of the old, to shape the future across Scotland, in the Western Isles, in Aberdeen, in the Borders, in Glasgow, and in every corner of this land. This Parliament has set itself many challenges. To be modern, not just in the use of technology, but in the way it engages with the people of Scotland in a climate of openness and accessibility. To understand the past, respecting those timeless values of probity and service to all the people of Scotland. As the first members of the new Scottish Parliament, you carry a heavy burden of responsibility in meeting these challenges. You will be called upon to exercise wisdom in using the powers of this Parliament, to make laws with care and deliberation, and to hold to account Scottish ministers and public servants to ensure good government for the people of Scotland. Yours will also be the obligation over the coming months to set lasting standards of vision and purpose, of debate and discussion, not just for our own generation, but for future generations. For those young people who have just performed so well outside this chamber, and those who will be parading past after the ceremony, carrying their banners and celebrating the enthusiasm of every constituency represented here today. The Duke of Edinburgh and Prince Charles, Duke of Rothesay, join me in wishing this Parliament every success. My prayers are with you all as you embark on this new and historic journey. I have trust in the good judgment of the Scottish people. I have faith in your commitment to their service, and I am confident in the future of Scotland. I am pleased, therefore, now to declare the Scottish Parliament open, and in so doing, to present to you this newly commissioned mace, a modern embodiment of an ancient symbol of power, legitimacy, and the relationship between Parliament and Crown. Let it serve to remind all of the lawful authority vested in the Scottish Parliament from today.
Queen's Gift is revealed. It's the work of silversmith Michael Lloyd. It is required to reflect the architectural themes of its new intended home, the permanent building at Holyrood. The staff has a band of Scottish gold around it, donated by gold panners working at One Lock Head. And round the head, it's engraved, "There shall be a Scottish Parliament, Scotland Act 1998. It also lists the qualities expected of MSPs: integrity,
the beginning
justice,
of a new song.
Wisdom." Now Tom Fleming.
Let our three-voiced country sing in a new world, joining the other rivers without dogma, but with friendliness to all around her. Let her new river shine on a day that is fresh and glittering and contemporary. Let it be true to itself and to its origins. Inventive, original, philosophical. Its institutions mirror its beauty. Then, without shame, we can esteem ourselves.
Work of the poet Ian Crichton-Smith, who died before he could see the Parliament reconvene, but his sentiments expressed beautifully by Tom Fleming.
Is there for honest poverty that hangs his head and all that? The coward slave, we pass him by, we dare be pair for all that. For all that and all that, our toils obscure and all that, the rank is but the guinea stamp, the man's the gold for all that. What though on him the fair we dine, we're hard and grey and all that. Give fools their silks and knaves their wine, a man's a man for all that. For all that and all that, their tinsel show and all that. The honest man, though e'er so pair, is king o' men for all that. You see on Birkie, Cardle Lord, o' struts and stairs and all that. Though hundreds worship at his word, he's but a coup for all that. For all that and all that, his raven star and all that, the man o' independent mind, he looks and locks at all that. A prince can mark a belted knight, a marquis duke and all that, but an honest man's up in his might, get faith he manna for that. For all that and all that, their dignities and all that, the pathos sense and pride o' worth, are higher rank than all that. Then let us pray that come it may, as come it will for all that, that sense and worth are o'er the air, shall bear the grief and all. Shall
Scottish sentiment. Sheena Wellington, accompanied by the Scottish Parliament impromptu choir. Sheena being one of Scotland's leading folk singers and currently the traditional arts development officer of Fife Council. Now, brotherhood, of course, is a sentiment that Donald Dewar's Labour movement has held dear in the past. He's among those now calling for a new politics of cooperation. His vote of thanks for the royal gift will be minutely examined for political significance. The First Minister.
That's what's called competition, I think. I always pull the right spots. Your Majesty, on behalf of the people of Scotland, I thank you for the gift of the mace. It's a symbol of the great democratic traditions from which we draw our inspiration and our strength. At its head are inscribed the opening words of our founding statute. There shall be a Scottish Parliament. Through long years, many long years in the case of many of us, those words were first a hope, then a belief, then a promise. Now, they are a reality. This is indeed a moment anchored in our history. Today, we can reach back through the long haul to win this Parliament, through the struggles of those who brought democracy to Scotland, to that other Parliament dissolved in controversy over 300 years ago. Today, we can look forward to the time when this moment will be seen as a turning point, the day when democracy was renewed in Scotland, when we revitalized our place in this, our United Kingdom. This is about more than our politics and our laws. This is about who we are, how we carry ourselves. And in the quiet moments of today, if there are any, we might have hear some echoes from the past. The shout of the welder in the din of the great Clyde shipyards, the speak of the Mearns rooted in the land, the discourse of the Enlightenment, when Edinburgh and Glasgow were indeed a light held to the intellectual life of Europe, the wild cry of the great pipes, and back to the distant noise of battles in the days of Bruce and Wallace. The past is part of us, part of every one of us, and we respect it. But today there is a new voice in the land, the voice of a democratic parliament, a voice to shape Scotland, a voice above all for the future. Walter Scott wrote that only a man with soul so dead could have no sense, no feel for his native land. For me, and I think in this I speak at least for any Scot today, this is a proud moment, a new stage in a journey begun long ago and which has no end. This is a proud day for all of us. A Scottish Parliament, not an end, but a means to greater ends. And these too are part of our mace. Woven into the symbolic thistles are these four words: wisdom, justice, compassion, integrity. Burns would have understood that. We've just heard, beautifully sung, one of his most enduring works. And at the heart of that song is a very Scottish conviction that honesty and simple dignity are priceless virtues, not imparted by rank or birth or privilege, but part of the soul. Burns believed that sense and worth ultimately prevail. He believed that was the core of politics, and that without it, our profession is inevitably impoverished. Wisdom, justice, compassion, integrity, timeless values, honourable aspirations for this new forum of democracy, born on the cusp of a new century. We are fallible. We all know that. We'll make mistakes. But I hope and I believe we will never lose sight of what brought us here, the striving to do right by the people of Scotland, to respect their priorities, to better their lot, and to contribute to the common weal. I look forward to the days ahead, and I know there will be many of them, when this chamber will sound with debate, argument, and passion, when men and women from all over Scotland will meet to work together for a future built on the first principles of social justice. But today, we pause and reflect. It is a rare privilege in an old nation to open a new parliament. Today is and must be a celebration of the principles, the traditions, the democratic imperatives which have brought us to this point, and which will sustain us in the future. Your Majesty, we are proud that you are here today to handle this Parliament and here with us as we dedicate ourselves to the work that lies ahead. Your Majesty, our thanks.
And the proceedings being transmitted to the crowds outside, they too welcoming Donald Dewar's emotion. We move to another generation now back inside the chamber. And to a poem.
How to Create a Great Country by Amy Lineker. So, you're a home baking expert and you want a challenge, but you don't have the faintest idea what. Well, here's a foolproof recipe. Go ahead, try it. Take several heroic battles, some kilts of tartan fine, a clearance's worth of emigration, a thistle's worth of spike, and a rebellion or two. Mix together with a spoon of fate and add Granny's best mince and tarties, corned beef hash or tarty soup, oor Willie's share of mischief, add a clove of garlic and a broad Scots tongue. Fold in gently an Edinburgh festival with all the trimmings, a football match between the greens and blues, a sleekit, cooing, timorous beastie by Rabbi Burns, and a life of design by Charles Rennie Mackintosh. Churn in on a production line, a few millennia of fishing, several thousand acres of farming, a steel furnace full of shipbuilding, and a fish supper with microchips. Leave to rise and mature and ice with a bright future of connections with the world, flourishing industries that embrace green living, high qualifications, low unemployment, and a fabulous new Scottish Parliament. Taste the wonderful, varied flavours and smile. You have made your first Scotland.
Mr. Connery appreciated that rendition from Victoria Joffe, who's 17, wearing the uniform of Craigholm School in Glasgow, but the poem was written by 11-year-old Amy Lineker from Sarsour. She won a writing competition with it. Now, from very modern to really ancient, and the voice of the Kirk in the Kirk's home, the psalm, All People That on Earth Do Dwell.
Thank you.
the chamber will be asked to remain standing as the Duke of Hamilton retrieves the crown and rejoins the royal procession, again led by the two heralds of the Lion Court, the Lord Lion himself. That's Carrick Herald, Carrick Pursuivant in front. That's Rothsay Herald behind, the Lord Lion, King at Arms. And then the Duke of Hamilton with the crown, Her Majesty immediately behind, on the principle that the crown and monarch should not be separated. Normally she would bring up the rear at any procession. Prince Philip, George Reed, the Deputy Presiding Officer, Prince Charles in the Duke of Rothsay role today, and Patricia Ferguson, the Labour Party Deputy Presiding Officer. The MPs now resume their seats. The Royal Party is on its way to specially built dais outside the Assembly Hall to view a parade of Scotland's children, but the MSPs will be allowed to make their own way there. I don't know if you can spot the way that they're dressed, but all of them have been issued with souvenir white heather buttonholes today, tied with Flower of Scotland tartan, provided for all 129 members. And the lineup there seems to be very happy with what they had, or overheard, maybe a better term, of the proceedings. There's a fine hat, a treatment of the saltire that I'm not sure would actually be approved of by the Lord Lion, King at Arms, but Sir Malcolm Innes of Edengicht, the current holder of the office, I'm sure, has a sense of humour. Now down the steps into the old courtyard again. John Knox still standing there, as you may get a glimpse, with his arm raised. He would probably find this monarchy more acceptable than the Mary Queen of Scots period of reign. I'm not sure what order of chivalry Mr. Dewar espouses. Hands in pockets alongside the Queen must be, I imagine, an offence of some description. He may just have realised that. Sir David, the First Minister, and Her Majesty, sure a joke. You have a better view of the Queen's outfit there. There is John Knox himself. I'm not qualified to talk about the outfit. I'll leave that for perhaps later in this programme. And as Her Majesty re-emerges onto the mound, my colleague Alan Little will bring you up to date with proceedings. Alan.
John, she's greeted by an enthusiastic cheer, as you can hear, from this substantial crowd gathered here on the mound. And a chance for them to see for the first time this much-talked-about outfit. Designed certainly according to the colours, and we're told also to the theme of the thistle. A centrepiece at the end of this whole ceremony is the parade of Scotland's youth. 1,600 children from around Scotland, drawn from every one of Scotland's 73 parliamentary constituencies, from Orkney and Shetland to Wigtonshire, will be taking part in the parade, and the signal for them to start will be a flypast by the Red Arrows. And that is due to happen in a few minutes' time. And we're told, weather permitting, that the Red Arrows will attempt to paint a saltire in the sky. That's the white on blue cross of St. Andrews that has for long been the national flag of Scotland. The Queen now mounting the dais. in offices and flats in the on the back of the Royal Mile at the Mound here, and Bank Street alongside the headquarters of the Bank of Scotland.
As we watch these pictures there of the Royal Party, the presiding officer and the First Minister of Scotland, the deputy presiding officers waiting for the children's parade to begin. Let's just reflect in that ceremony. Ian Hamilton, first of all, an affirmation of egalitarian virtues. It was very, and not very informal, jokes about the Duke of Rossi.
Yes, the informality of it, and yet the touch of an enormous genius to have the song, the song about ordinary people. And I would like to, I'd love to know who put this programme together, but I would like to think that it was Donald Dewar himself who said, we're going to have a man's man and all that. It was wonderful.
But the mixture was tremendous, this Lockhead, wasn't it? With James McMillan's fanfares, but also the poem.
The poem by the 11-year-old,
yes,
which was
moving
and funny and clever and delivered so brilliantly.
Yeah.
I think it must be just amazing to be there. You would think you're... Your heart would stop, your voice in your throat, and Sheena Wellington sang that song, made everybody join in. Brilliant.
It's been a festival of joy.
And we can see now the school children coming down.
Kirsty, I can tell you something about the parade that is now taking place. It was supposed to be led by the Edinburgh School Samba Band. I don't see them yet. They'll be along shortly. But they're led there by the Pipe Band, and they are drawn from all the constituencies, the parliamentary constituencies of Scotland, each carrying these banners which represent the regions they come from, marching rather like the opening ceremony of an Olympic Games in alphabetical order, Aberdeen South, Banff and Buchan. And these banners were designed with the help of a well-known Buddhist monastery in Dumfriesshire. And they're designed on the principle of the Himalayan prayer flag. They're all in these sweatshirts, which you can see with the logo, one representing the 1st of July, the first day of this new political dispensation, and the flag of St. Andrews, the saltire, written through it. No, they're not in alphabetical order. Dumfries, Galloway and Upper Nithsdale. And the symbols represent aspects of Scottish life: history, modernity, tradition, agriculture, fisheries, the land and the sea, and so on. Their way down towards Prince's Street and to Prince's Street Gardens, where we saw earlier the crowds gathered to look at those big screens where the proceedings of the Parliament Hall and the Parliament Chamber were beamed to the delight of the public. And nature truly has smiled on this day. It is a magnificent day, the kind of day on which Edinburgh, the splendour of this city, is truly revealed. Thank you. The colours of these flags are chosen, the red, yellow and purple, chosen to be politically neutral, to be non-sectarian, and they will be planted later in above Princes Street Gardens, where the celebrations of the day will continue, on the Castle Hill, which so dominates the skyline of Edinburgh.
So there we have all the banners coming down, passed down onto the mound and round. And some, you know, Argyll and Bute, Ochil, all these places, children from Orkney, Laura Barrett, Nicholas Spence from Orkney, Paisley South, Jennifer Thompson. Special day for all of them. Liz Lockett.
Oh, wonderful to see the children of Scotland in these. It's a touch of genius, just a simple sweatshirt with this logo on it, and there they are, just marching forward into the future. It's fantastic.
Andrew Neil, when you look back on the ceremony, what were your feelings about the ceremony?
I thought it captured the mood of the kind of nation we'd like to be. The Parliament's got a tough job to make us that kind of nation, but it set the right goals.
It certainly set out what was required before the Parliament would earn people's respect.
I think it also showed that within the United Kingdom, things can be done differently. This was a different kind of pageant from London. We associate London with the big royal events and things like we see in the screen right now. This almost had a medieval quality to it in the nicest sense of scale. It wasn't the Mall, it wasn't Buckingham Palace, it was Holyrood Palace, the Royal Mile, the informality of it as well, and yet still a sense of symbolism and of royalty and democracy too. So I think it showed that things can be different.
We can see Sean Connor and his wife standing there looking at the children as they went past. It has a feeling of being very European. I mean, it's partly to do with the architecture, isn't it? It's partly to do with the narrow streets and the high tenements and so forth, people looking down on this. But also, it was interesting that what David Steele said was, we welcome the monarch, Queen of Scots, sitting amongst us, not overlooking us, but amongst us. I mean, that sentiment was very clearly in Hamilton.
Yes, indeed.
That's a fundamental difference, that in England, she's the Queen of England, representing the conquerors of England. Scotland has never been conquered. In Scotland, if she has any function at all, she's a first among equals and nothing else.
A lot was going to be made about not only the extent of the Queen's involvement today, but about her mode of dress. And on a serious note, I mean, when she was here in her first official visit after the coronation and wore modern dress, there was a lot of criticism for it. But today, in a sense, modern dress is much more in keeping with the atmosphere. I mean, it would have been bizarre, wouldn't it, to have had on, as it were, formal robes.
Exactly, she looks absolutely magnificent. Those colours, just glowing and glorious.
What we've got here is strong colours, Andrew Neil, but I mean, if I come to you for a fashion statement here, something very, very subtle but very dignified.
And also something quite Scottish about it. That purple seems Scottish, and the tartan and the Scottish brooch. So, I mean, I think it's been a triumph for the Queen. And as you know, I'm not the biggest cheerleader of the monarchy. I think she's obviously enjoyed it as well. She's been smiling away almost as much as Sean Connery at this. So I think she's enjoying watching the school kids go past. It's gone without a hitch, as far as the Queen's been concerned.
Now, we must cut away now, because above the skies of Edinburgh, coming over the capital, we're going to see Concord and the Red Arrows.
Wow.
We're watching the skies now. They're going to appear overhead any moment now. And here they come. Approaching Edinburgh, Concord, Mike Bannister, the pilot of Concord, brought Concord up last night, hired a small plane and travelled the route to see exactly where he was going to fly in formation with the Red Arrows. Still one of the great British symbols, Concord, feat of engineering. They're actually going to fly, hopefully, at something like 1,000 feet. Imagine that. A formation over the sea, south over Fife into East Lothian, west to Preston Pans. Only takes 6 minutes to get from the centre of Edinburgh to the centre of Glasgow and Concord. That's the way to commute. Never mind the railway in the morning.
Though culturally, the two cities are about 6 light years apart.
See the children there, again, this informality, they're taking photographs. Look, isn't that a magnificent sight? Wonder what the noise will be like when it actually finally comes overhead.
It's a noisy plane. Hope the windows of the Bank of Scotland up there by the mound are going to survive intact.
And then presumably the red arrows will break off and make the formation into the saltire over the sky.
I think this adds an image of modernity for Scotland, which is important for our international image, that it isn't just heather and tartan, that we are
technology.
Part of the 21st century.
Yes, indeed. Important for our self-image too.
Yes, the ceremony was modern, you know, both modern and domestic and medieval. It seems that they've managed to combine all these things together in a really quite magical way. Yep.
But I mean, look, there's Margaret Ewing coming out, handing out saltires to the children. The idea of the closeness of it all, that's it. Winnie Ewing there, and Margaret Ewing presumably talking to someone she knows, a teacher carrying some of the children from Cunningham South. Skipping out to see the children. And again, Concord. Being picked up by one of our many cameras over the city. There we have Paisley South, Paisley North, West Renfrewshire.
Shetland.
Here comes, and there's a tail plane in behind Concord there. It's probably been keeping Concord in line.
I think it must be very difficult to fly formation with Concord.
Well, I would have thought.
Here we come, look over at Holyrood Palace.
Wow.
Any moment now, Concord will be over the mound. Red Arrow in front, leading the way. Straight up the old Norlaw. Like a great glorious bird in the sky.
Well, that was exciting.
Yeah.
It was fast and very
exciting.
It's always
exciting.
And of course, the next big noise from Edinburgh will presumably be the 1 o'clock gun. And there we see the number one, the saltire figure from the day's events, into the gardens in front of the mound. We have more children now. Just pick out some names here. Woodmill Hyne from Dunfermline West, Clevedon Secondary from Annisland, Holyrood Secondary from Shettleston, young Graham McKenzie is down from Caithness, Sutherland and Easter Ross. Ross Skye and Inverness West, Margaret Cassidy. All these children brought down yesterday, arriving in buses this morning anyway, and then staying on in the park for their own other celebrations this afternoon. Andrew Neil, Donald Dewar said, I count myself lucky indeed to be playing my part in the hard work of turning visions into reality, a working constitutional settlement not for Scotland but for the UK as a whole. The implications for the whole of the United Kingdom haven't really been really settled yet, but they will over the next 10-15 years. It will become quite clear that there is a separate constitutional settlement.
Well, I think the implications for the rest of Britain have yet to dawn on the rest of Britain, particularly the English. This is a constitutional settlement for Scotland, but it will have huge implications for the rest of the country, and it will change the way Parliament operates as well. It will change even the idea of where sovereignty lies. It changes the nature of that, because in the Scottish tradition, sovereignty lies with the people, not with the Parliament or with the Crown and Parliament. And I think that will be in many ways.
Well, do you think this is the touch paper then for a different view of the sovereign throughout the United Kingdom, in a sense, the new relationship?
My own view is that if the monarchy is to survive in the 21st century, it has to copy the Scottish model. That there is to be respectful for a head of state, but not deferential to a head of state. For a monarchy to survive in a democratic age, it has to come from the people, not be imposed from the top. That is the Scottish tradition, and I think there is something to learn for the United Kingdom as a whole.
And the Queen also today, I mean, she praised a lot of attributes of Scots, as you would do if she was in Wales or in England or Northern Ireland for that matter, but there was a genuine affection.
Yes, I think there is. I mean, the royal family is always a bit of a love affair with Scotland. Probably, I think, more Scottish blood in this royal family than there is English blood. And they enjoy coming here. She's clearly enjoyed herself today. And she always does rise to the occasion when it's... this could have been a dodgy time for her today. There was a lot of argument about what her exact role was being. I'd have thought she's done her own cause quite a lot of good today.
And stepping out with the presiding officer, with the First Minister, very much among equals.
Yes. You see, this could never... the Queen could never go to the House of Commons. In the House of Commons, Black Rod knocks on the door and summons the members of Parliament to the House of Lords, where the Queen addresses them. But in this new way of doing things, the Queen is invited and sits in this Parliament by invitation.
We'll make our new traditions, won't we? I mean, this is the thing.
As it writes a passage.
We're not stuck with a whole set of things that are laid down in stone. And I think it does make for enormous changes everywhere. Just one small chink, something changes, and it's definitely the start of something.
Well, Donald Durham himself called it a process, didn't he? And he wasn't us necessarily meaning about the political settlement. I think he was meaning, presumably, also about the whole nature of identity in Scotland as well.
I think so, and the whole idea of what democracy really, really means right throughout Britain, I think, will change because of things like this and things being done in this way.
I mean, can you imagine, I mean, in Westminster, people would stand up and sing, clap, make jokes.
But you could have a Freedom Camogie and an unaccompanied singer standing up, like in a room, singing to her equals. It was wonderful.
Yes, I think we've got off to an absolutely super start with today's
proceedings. Couldn't have done better, they really couldn't.
And the Queen moves forward to be greeted by Eric Milligan and other members of the civic procession here. And then we'll move down to talk to some of the children. Get a small posy there that looks as if it has thistles at the edges. Again, purple, yellow and red, the colours of the banners echoed in the colours of the flowers. And very soon we will see all these banners fluttering from Castle Hill. See, there again, people aren't bowing or curtsying, they're just being respectful.
Yes, there was a real significance in that statement, you sit among us. That really, 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 really means something, I think.
Lack of security is, you know, pretty stunning here, isn't it? I mean, presumably the security does exist, but it's invisible.
It's clearly a bit of a security nightmare. Of course, we're lucky in Scotland to have a tradition that these things go off, keep our fingers crossed, without any of that kind of trouble. And the security can be low-key. It doesn't have to be intrusive.
But I'm enormously pleased for Donald Dewar, whose tail I have twisted on innumerable occasions. But I'm so happy for him. And that quite wonderful speech which he gave, which I'm absolutely certain was Donald himself.
Oh, Donald would have written that himself, all right. He likes to do that, and he knows enough of the history and the literature of the land to write things like that.
This is a day for three cheers for Donald.
Yes, that was poetry too. I mean, poetry has really been keynote of the whole thing, from Ian Crichton-Smith's new song straight into the oldest song. And it seemed to me that Donald Dewar was singing a song, really, for Scotland too in that speech.
Very much so.
And the cars are going to, once the Queen pulls away, the cars will move and the royal party will return to Holyrood, and then very slowly the guests will move up the mound and they will have a reception at Parliament Hall and spilling into the Signet Library. And there is Her Majesty the Queen with the Duke of Edinburgh and the Duke of Rossi making their way now away from the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland. Well, the other thing which, of course, is going to be unique in the United Kingdom is never before, and presumably never again, will a parliament be built so close to a royal residence?
No, in a way that's quite symbolic too, because traditionally parliament and crown have been at loggerheads. And if they're as close together geographically now as they will be when the new parliament is built down by Holyrood, then it may be that there is the beginning of a remaking of a monarchy for the 21st century, as well as a
remaking of Scottish
democracy.
And for you to say that as a man who has espoused republicanism.
No, that's not true. I've never espoused republicanism.
Well, not a bicycling monarchy.
I've never been, or even a bicycling monarchy. Actually, this shows that there is a middle way between the traditional British royalty and the Scandinavian bicycle royalty.
And there we have Sean Connery, flanked by Gus MacDonald, Margaret Ewing.
Yes, so it is.
Mingus Campbell, John Swinney there in front, and there, coming up behind, more MSPs.
I wonder what happened.
The other thing is there's a great number of people here from all over the world. I just saw a member of the Greek embassy there. I mean, people have come here to celebrate as well, haven't they?
I wonder what happened to Michael Douglas and Catherine Zeta-Jones. But they might have stayed overnight for this.
You see, and it's interesting today because more salt house, not so many lion rampants. And I know, Ian, that not necessarily you espouse this sort of thing, but you do know all about tradition. And the Lord Lion, you've got to officially to apply to the Lord Lion before you can fly the lion rampant.
You know, I didn't know that. I don't know anything about
clearly,
it.
Clearly today people are much happier to fly this, so I've been doing my homework.
This is good Scottish tradition.
There's a lion rampant.
There's one lion rampant there, just to disprove me. So Liz Lockhead, what would you take away from today? Because it's been a mixture of so many things.
I think really the poetry, which I was scared that the day would be lacking in poetry. But Donald Dewar's speech, which really contained the fire of poetry, and I think that's what we need, is this vision so that we can go somewhere with it.
One of your fellow writers, Willie McAvaney, said that for so long, Scottish culture was defined about how it fought against that of Thatcherism, and that was very much how it saw itself. And that what would they do after that?
Okay, I think that's daft. You might as well say people shouldn't go for therapy because after that they'll be cured of the neurosis and not be creative anymore. That's just really silly. I mean, I think we're going to have lots to write about, lots to think about as we change. And if we didn't change, then we'd be stuck.
And as a newspaper editor, clearly, I mean, what you've also talked about in the past, and you talked about in the lead-up not only to the referendum but to the election, was the need for rigour in the press. And presumably you, of all people, were saying you need a lot of rigour when you look and see what actually happens in this parliament.
Well, I think that the Scottish press has a rigorous tradition, and now there is a parliament on our doorstep. We can be pretty sure we'll be annoying these MSPs at every opportunity and holding them to account. The Queen herself said today that these MSPs bear a heavy burden. So this is a hard act to live up to make this work, to follow on from this. And there is still the unresolved question. Will this lead to a more content and prosperous Scotland within the United Kingdom, or is this the first stage in a move to the breakup of Britain? That is the overarching question in British politics.
But with, as it were, such an optimistic start, not least because of the weather and the whole atmosphere today, I mean, the idea that this is an evolution, even in terms of reserve powers, that the powers that the Parliament has at the moment are only, as it were, part of the story, and that things will accrue. I mean, do you see a tension between Westminster and Scotland?
Oh, I think there is inevitably going to be a tension, because unlike a full federal structure where everything is laid down, this is a work in progress. And there will be inevitable tensions between Edinburgh and London as Edinburgh wants to accrue more powers. And also the Scottish people will have to make up their mind based on the performance of this parliament that we have if they deserve more powers. So there's at least one thing is true. There's going to be plenty to write and broadcast about.
Ian, ultimately I know you want an independent Scotland, but what
yes.
will you be looking for? What does this day tell you about what's going to happen in the future, if anything?
I think today is extremely important because the cringe has gone. We are looking at ourselves and looking out proudly at the rest of the world. We're not looking to London to tell us what to do. We're a nation again, and that is the importance of today.
Do you think that we're seen more as a European nation, Andrew, than the totality of the United Kingdom having a European
I think that's bent? One of the Scottish conceits. That Scotland, there's an element within the Scottish political elite that would like to be more European, but that's essentially that is a nationalist agenda, because as Ireland now defines itself to Brussels rather than London, the nationalist agenda would like to do that as well. That's an attempt to downgrade London and its importance as the national capital. As I go around, I don't find this a more European. I think this part of Edinburgh is more European in its architecture.
And people watching this programme will see an Edinburgh, which is not, of course, the whole story about Edinburgh.
But I don't think that we're necessarily more or less European than the English.
I think Europeans find us more European than they find the rest of Britain.
Well, I think that's partly because they associate most things that Britain have done that they've not liked with England. And mm-hmm. It's always, I mean, I live in France part of the year. If you say you're Scottish rather than English, you get a bigger smile. They just don't realise that most of the British regiments that did them down were actually Scottish.
Liz Lockhead, as a writer then, how do you think you would be turning today into some form of verse or paragraphs about a new Scotland?
That's not the kind of thing I do, so I wouldn't be doing that. But it's just great to be here. I would like to be here, sitting here as a citizen rather than as a subject. But nevertheless, it's a very good start, and it's just been a great day.
Well, thank you all very much indeed. So all the former proceedings are over now. The emphasis is very much on informality and fun. There's a picnic in the park for all the children who took part, music all over the city through the day, and street theatre. The banners will soon hang in their holders all over the castle in the grounds. And we also close tonight with a fireworks display. Very soon it will seem to people inconceivable that Scotland would not have her own parliament. It will be part of the landscape, an enduring national symbol of a modern nation. Tomorrow morning, members of the Scottish Parliament will be expected to turn up for work at 9:30, ready to debate local government, which just goes to show it's not all excitement. Today, though, the First Minister of Scotland, Donald Dewar, said that Scotland's Parliament is not an end, but a means to greater ends. From Edinburgh on this historic day for the United Kingdom, goodbye.
And you can see highlights of today's colourful celebrations from the heart of historic Edinburgh, along with the Queen's address to the MSPs and Scotland's new Parliament, at 10 o'clock tonight here on BBC One Scotland.
I'm worried about Libby. She's got so much work on.